I'm an occupational therapist. I was trained in a med school for 8 years, and I joined Umeed as a part of the occupational therapy team. And I started working with children, and I started seeing older kids. And as they were coming for sessions, they didn't want to do activities, they wanted to talk about things. And I didn't have the skills to talk to people, talk to children and build their stories. So I was finding it really hard because I was so trained to be an expert in a med school that I had to tell them what to do all the time. And here was 16-year-olds, 15-year-olds who didn't want to listen to me, and I didn't feel comfortable telling them what to do. So it was interesting that then we started having conversations, but I didn't have skills to build them. And I started having conversations with Jill because she was sitting closer to my desk, and we started having conversations, and she would help me think and give me suggestions. Maybe you can ask these questions. And I realized what it was doing in our conversation. And then the mental health training program at Umeed, which is a 1-year-long training program that happens. So I did that, and I realized that the shift that it got me, I shifted from a paradigm of expert-based model mm-hmm. to more of a collaborative model, and which sort of got me thinking, what should I do? So I started combining occupational therapy and narrative therapy together in my work.
So, I mean, I could think of so many kids that I work with, and yes, like Shaman said, initially it's a little different, but as you go along, I can think of the kids right now, and I remember this one kid particularly when we had like a reauthoring conversation, and at the end he's like, oh my god, I don't believe I'm so good. You know, like, I can't believe it, because it's like he said that I've never articulated all of mm-hmm. this, and he did not know that he could articulate so much. And I think the questions kind of helped him, and he just went out feeling, you know, I'm so good, and went and told his mom that.
So I think it is very different than probably most of what is sort of taught in schools or when you train to be psychologists or counselors. There is still a very expert-driven model, and there is a lot of expectation even from families when they come to you that you would have the answers, or that you would be able to tell them what to do or where to go. So it is, in that sense, it is different. But I think what we do find is that when families are given the opportunities, they do take them up, and that it does work so much better than us having to sort of give the answers, or that doesn't seem to fit. And mm-hmm. and a lot of times you don't have the answers, because, you know, they know their experience best.
And I work a lot with children with high functioning autism, and some of them have, like Jill said, they've articulated a lot about what they want, what their hopes for themselves are. And what happens is that when we share these things with parents, a lot of times parents have said that, I never knew that he had these, you know, abilities in himself. We just always told him what to do. And so I think that also made a huge difference when they were able to realize what they wanted for themselves. And mm-hmm. and somewhere when we had those joint sessions with the parents actually being outsider witnesses to some of those conversations really helped, because it made the story more powerful for the child as well as for the parents. And even in terms of, we've used it with disclosure, we've used it in the sense of helping children and parents realize what next steps are, what next steps they want to do. And I think it works really well, because it's as a team. It's not like parents telling us or telling the children what to do. It's more like they want to do something. So I think narrative is really, really powerful, because it gives a lot of agency to the person.
The space, I think, when we do these conversations is so non-judgmental. Of the conversations that people bring, the things that they bring to us, and it makes that space for them to talk about things and to deconstruct and construct meanings that they want to. Mm-hmm. I'm working with this kid who's influenced significantly my work, and he comes from a background where his father sold him to a drug dealer, and then the mom died during delivering him, and he was then, the father died, the social worker got him from the drug dealer, he shifted to a family of a different religion, and this family didn't accept the religion that he was from. So there were a lot of misunderstandings, a lot of problems, he was being abused in different ways, and the social worker got him to me, then I started seeing him, And the space allowed us to deconstruct the idea of family, that it's not about people who are related to you blood in by blood, but it's about people who take care of you and people who support you in your journey. It allowed him to create a new family, and we invited all those people through letters and through conversations. And I think it's this space and the power that it provides people to create the meaning that they want to, and not surrounded by the dominant ideas of the discourses. And I think it's just amazing.
She said that every time this one particular adult, after some time, would go and bang his head against the window. So what we used to do is, we used to, whenever he would bang his head against the window, we used to call the parents and say, you need to, you know, re-look at his medication because there's something not right. You know, he keeps banging his head and we can't control him in class. And she's like, the moment we started hearing, you know, learning about these ideas and how that, you know, it kind of opened our listening skills and also opened our way of looking at things. She said that we realized that there might be something that's not working for him in the context, in the class, and it might not be related to him. So we used to internalize saying, you know, that's his problem. But now what we did is we kept him out of class for 2 days, and we realized it was the smell that was becoming too much, which was a sensory overload, which was getting him too. And she's like, I wouldn't have ever realized it without the training that took place. So they're using ideas and they're using it in their own ways.
And we can see the change, we can feel the change, we can see them smiling throughout the sessions. When we meet them for supervision, they have been seeing comments like what my supervisors have told me, you know, it's so unsettling, it's so different. We are thinking that now disability is not disability, but it's so contextual, that I don't see a child as a disabled child, but it's a context that makes him disabled. And they are able to now locate the problem outside the child and look it in the context and figure it out in the socio-political system, because they go into the community and they have the best knowledge of that social-political system within the community. And I think now they're able to see and figure that out, and now their work is revolving around working on the context and not just on the child and the disability in the child, but in the context. And they feel so good about it. They feel that they are not judging the family and the child, that they are not... I think the biggest concern for a lot of organizations that approached us was the burnout of their social workers and community health workers. And the burnout, I think, came from the idea that they had to take charge of the community. But when they came to the space where they realized that the community is expert and they can be a facilitator in a collaborative way, they realized there was a way that the burnout will never happen to them, because they are now partnering with the community. And I think that was such a sense of empowerment for them as community health workers.
I know that there are several people in, not only over here, but in UMED, we have a team of 65, and a lot of those 65 have been trained now in narrative ideas, and they're all using it in different contexts of their work, and that is just really powerful for us to see as a team.
Trained. So we had some occupational therapists, physiotherapists, developmental pediatricians, special educators, and some of them have also done the one-year mental health training program, which is again a program which we run for professionals. And in that program, it's a one-year training program with 4 different blocks in narrative ideas. And I think the USP again of all our trainings is that we offer a lot of supervision. So we have once a week meetings with our supervisees, and maybe like 4 or 5 supervisees have one supervisor assigned to them, where we discuss cases, and we also do a lot of skill building. So the teaching blocks are separate, which are 4 all over the year. And in between, we have supervision where they come and they discuss challenging cases and skill building happens. And so 2 of our pediatricians have done those training programs. We have special educators who've done that. So they go and have conversations with their team members, and they see again that, you know, this is something very different and it's working. And so the interest has kind of moved from 5 to 10 to 15, and now like we saw 60 people.
Yeah. I think seeing people using it in a different context all the time keeps us thinking, oh, you know, there's no stopping of it. Like, you can use it in different contexts, and we have been trying so many different ways. we run a father's group of children, of fathers of children with disabilities, and it's been an amazing journey. I co-facilitated with the father, and it was amazing to partner with somebody who belongs to that community and to facilitate it together as partners.
So I joined fairly recently to the team, and I think that's, they work, I mean, they say all this, but they work incredibly hard to get it all done. And coming from sort of an outside perspective, coming in new, I see how much work, and it really pushes you to do your best as well. And they just absorb you in, and they make those narrative ideas just, they are fantastic, but they really bring it home. And I was really lucky to come in when they started planning the conference, and I was a part of that excitement, and it's going to be so fabulous. I'm so excited to be just the poster presentations from people from all over the world, including some of the work which we've discussed over here. We've got speakers, international, and Jay is going to be saying a keynote as well, which is really exciting.
Yes.
The upcoming conference is from the 13th to the 18th of October this year. That's 2016.
And we really, really, you know, would welcome everybody that wants to come. Yeah. It's called A Room Full of Stories, and we're just really excited.